All right, guys, here we are in the shop. How you doing? Thanks for tuning in. I'm Jimmy. We're making it work. I'm getting the shop opened up first thing in the morning. You guys have been around a while. You know how it goes. Got to get things fired up, start our day. We got quite a bit going on over here now. We're wiring in these lifts. And if you saw yesterday's video, we asked a big company around here about to do electrical work. They got to improve this box. I mean, there's a little bit of work to do. They want to improve the box. They said something about changing the tubing, probably to PVC from steel tubing. And they want like $11,000 to do it. It's basically a day's work, but maybe even half a day for an electrician. But we're not here for wiring and lifts. We're doing it ourselves for 180 bucks. You probably already know that if you saw yesterday's video. But I still feel compelled to make sure everyone's up to speed. So we got quite a few things. We got heavy trucks getting brake work and stuff behind me. We got a ton of Chryslers and Jeeps and Kias. Seems to be mostly what we work on lately. Man, the sun is up this morning. 70 degrees this morning, so it's going to be a warm day. Probably mid 80s, up slightly upper 80s. We'll see. I hope the weather's good by you. What we're going to do here is put in some clips, and that way you'll know what to expect in this video. Welcome to Toyota, but it's our next one. Nissan Sentra. He said, get my AC working. Honda Civic. All right, so we got a beautiful sunrise, even though it's already getting a little warm this morning. 7:15 in the morning. So we should have a nice day. I hope we're going to be busy. I know the boss is coming by to talk. Remember I mentioned insurance to you guys last week? Boss is coming by to talk about that, so I might lose my insurance today. We'll see. Because the plan that Katie was showing me, I'm not going to pay for that. If I have no insurance and something catastrophic happens, they're going to take care of me anyway, and I'll just make payments then. Let's finish getting the shop open up, get in there to do our best, and learn a thing or two. And we're definitely going to have some fun. You guys know that. Let's do it. Stay tuned. Now we got a broken Toyota, but this poor thing has seen some life. Uh-oh, it's locked. Good thing. Now you can't just leave a car like this out in the parking lot unlocked and unattended to. I'd probably have armed guards around it 24/7. Front brakes, 227,521 miles. But all kidding aside, the car's actually in nice shape. You know, it's reasonably clean, like a 6. Just the paint's faded, but it's not too bad. I mean, looks like a nice daily driver. 227,000 miles, my goodness gracious. Toyota, it's just getting broken in, don't worry. Front brakes and rotors, and this thing will be like a new car. Very slow today, by the way, I apologize, but it doesn't look like we're gonna have a very busy video. We'll do what we can, you know, we'll try to make it work, and we'll try to get some, whoever back on the road, we're able to get back on the road, that's what we're gonna do. That's our plan every day. Focus on getting people fixed up, and the income happens, hopefully. I'm gonna pop the hood, make sure the brake fluid's okay and there's nothing contaminated. I wanna say I recommended the brakes on this car. Told him front and rear, but I think she's gonna do the front now and the rear another day. And let's get to it. Stop talking. Let's work. And a 17. All right. Let's see what the right angle impact has to say. Nothing but a thing, chicken wing. All I'm not sure if the pads they get me are gonna come with hardware, so I'm gonna not mess the hardware up on purpose. I'm gonna clean those up. A little bit of fresh orange goodness. There's a reason that they don't have tons of grease, although these are replacement calipers because they always have that white grease and there's always a little too much of it. You generally don't want any grease on the tip because that forces it to kind of hydrolock. So just in the low spots. I apologize, this repetitive for some of the guys who watch all my videos, which I really appreciate that. YouTube is crushing me this month. I'm not doing anything different, but my watch time is down like 1,200 hours. My viewing clicks are 30,000 down. My subscriber count is down 50 from last month. I'm not doing anything different. Maybe my videos suck more last week. I don't know. I'm gonna keep doing what I do. That's all I'm gonna do. Alright. Don't worry. I brought a more serious impact with me. We'll get it. Just like we'll get more subscribers. I think when I don't post shorts, I get less subscribers and views. Because YouTube promotes shorts a lot. They don't promote long form much anymore. I don't know why. Probably because they make more money that way too, so. And I only make shorts when I think I find something funny or interesting or silly. I don't really like to make short content because it doesn't really serve a purpose. You guys tell me if I'm wrong, but to me, short content, short videos are for distraction. Some people have ADHD and they really need to jump around and watch 10 and 15 second videos. Because to focus for a long time is hard for some people, and I understand that. But I'm trying to make these videos to be a little productive, have some fun, maybe learn a little something here and there. You know, that's why I say it every morning. Because that's my goal. It's not just something I say, it's something I mean. Let's see if the parts are here for this thing. Always just clean up your hub, make sure there's no loose dirt or rust, etc., etc. This looks like you would feel it and need to clean it up, but it's perfectly smooth. No worries. Potts is here. You ever notice how these boxes always have extra catches on the corner? I just go like this. Works for me. You kids with stronger fingers, you probably just rip it open. But, oh, those aren't mine. Maybe they pulled the wrong part number. That's cool. It's got little tiny rotors and giant pads are half the size of the rotors. I thought they felt heavy. I'm like, why such a big box? Let's see if the rotors are right before we go up and up front and let them know. They just brought those pads with these rotors. And it's not an uncommon thing anymore. You got to do everything twice, three times. That's where everybody makes more money, by doing stuff over and over. The rotor looks right. Put these in your electronics drawers. All right, let me go let them know those pads are not right. All right, the right pads are here. They pulled the wrong part number. So, we're back in business. These shims are all the same, no direction. The old ones weren't in bad shape, but it comes with them. Might as well use them as long as they look like they're bent correctly. These are aftermarket too, actually. See, there wasn't any lubrication underneath them. They rusted. At least there's rust starting. Some people on my channel are making comments about my blueprint engine for the project truck, which is pretty funny. I think some of these guys that leave these comments, it's like their mom left the room for a minute, so they jump on her laptop to antagonize people. She went to go make them a peanut butter and jelly sandwich.
so they leave a comment while she's gone. At least that's the vibe. When you're a useless person, you want everyone else to be sad too. When you're a good person, you want everyone else to be happy. And you build them up. That's just how it is. I already lubricated my caliper contact points. She is waiting in the waiting room too, so I'm trying to knock this out quick. And if you haven't seen my other brake videos, just in case, we are getting some new subscribers. There's a little ledge there. You got to make sure that that notch goes into that ledge. Next one. Oh man, it must be a tiny little person. My gracious goodness, I can't fit in there. All right. 2008 Acura RDX, I think this thing is. Transmission warning lights are coming on. And that's not the right key. Why would you fold the key up when... I only fold them up when I put them in my pocket. Have I mentioned that before? 182,447 miles. Said no drivability concerns, but the transmission warning is blinking. Or the light. The brake pedal feels low to me. That's why I was looking at my foot. But didn't ask about that. We'll get in the shop. I'm not going to drive it. She said she doesn't feel anything wrong. It just sees the light on. I just pull it in. Maybe we'll take a look at some fluid if it has a dipstick. And we'll see what kind of codes it might have and that kind of thing. A lot of times on these, if a solenoid's going bad or a connection's bad, it'll blink the D light and that kind of thing. I'm going to go ahead and give her a love rating of 5. You know, a little clutter here and there. Nothing wrong with being thirsty. Not a crime. Let's see what this says. Tire Kingdom full synthetic oil change. $73. That's not bad. All right, let's get the scanner, see what we got. Auto scan. That Toyota Corolla. New car. Basically like a new car with 227,000 miles and new brakes. It does have new tires on it and stuff too. That's actually in pretty decent shape. Paint's messed up, I think. But the car's actually pretty solid. So... no sevens. Oh, this is going to be USA, I'm guessing. I don't know. It may have come down from Canada with it. Who can tell for sure? Got Florida tags on it, I believe. Okay. I don't even know what those things say. They just give you some warnings and stuff. And you just hit okay and it goes past it. automatic transmission code 1. No codes in the ECM. Usually if there's a code in the transmission, you'll get a code in the ECM. Or vice versa, and they'll let you know, hey, there's a code somewhere else too, ABS. Usually when those two codes go together, you're dealing with wheel speed sensor issues. The vehicle speed sensor and wheel speed sensor don't agree, kind of thing. But we'll see. We'll let this finish chit chat, and apparently it's going to take a while. We're only at 20% and I've been flapping my gums for a minute. We'll let that run and we'll come back. looks okay, smells bad, and it tastes questionable. I'm sent the report. Let's go over some codes.
Transmission fluid pressure switch C, fourth clutch circuit high. Current code, right front wheel speed sensor failure. Current code in the ABS. ECM-PCM relation failure, current ABS. Headlight on position circuit malfunction. AC codes, etc. Tire pressure codes. That says low air pressure, not sensor problem. Oh, low battery voltage. Yeah, all the sensors show low battery voltage and low air pressure. But if it's showing low air pressure, shouldn't it? Okay, maybe these codes aren't. Oh, they're all current. That's odd. So, probably needs sensors and air pressure. What'll probably happen with that, I would think, that when the voltage is so low, it's still reading, just not accurately and all the time kind of thing, like it goes in and out kind of deal. Like when your analog clock battery goes dead, it still kind of works. Same kind of thing. But they got AC codes, TPMS codes, ABS and transmission codes, basically. The BCM codes. So there's a lot of codes. My concern is this automatic transmission code. We're going to see which solenoid is that one. We can make sure it's plugged in. 873. What I do like about this too is this code search feature. You can go online. It'll take you online and shows you what risk level. Stop driving. Repair immediately. She says she doesn't feel anything wrong. It probably slips in fourth gear or something. She just doesn't feel it. This is a five-speed transmission. It's probably not in fourth gear very long kind of thing. So let me go look this code up, find out if there's any particular fuses. Maybe, you know, normally they won't have a fuse for each solenoid. It would be for all of them. We'll have to check and see which one it is on the transmission. I'm no accurate transmission expert by any means. So we'll find out which one it is, make sure it's plugged in, that kind of thing. And we're also going to take a look at those ABS sensors. That we can do really quick. Exit code search. Back out here. We'll go to ABS. Shut this door. We'll go to ABS. I'll bring up all four wheels on the data stream and we'll take a look at that, see what it looks like, make sure we're getting readings from all four. Right front wheel speed, right rear wheel speed, graph, combine. Now we'll just roll backward and forward. Try not to touch the, anytime I touch the ALDO, it turns off and I lose my connection, so I gotta be really careful about that. Not reading anything. It's got no wheel speed. I'm just rolling in and out of the bay here to see what would happen. Usually you got to go above 3 miles an hour. One of them is missing. I didn't see an orange one. See how it popped up, but not for all of them. We'll have to see if she wants to look into that. At first I'm going to look up the tranny code since she asked about that. Okay, this code is for the transmission pressure switch fourth. Transmission pressure switch. It tells it when the clutch has been energized hydraulically, changes the pressure to that switch. Computer sends a 5-volt reference to that switch, and all it does is ground the 5-volt reference. So it'll be open in one condition, off or on, and closed in the opposite condition. So if it's normally open, which is what I believe it's normally open, when it sees pressure, it closes and grounds. So the computer's not seeing it close to ground when it activates the fourth gear clutch. Now that could mean the fourth gear clutch isn't working, could mean the switch is bad, could mean there's a broken wire, could mean 5 volts isn't coming from the computer. So basically I told him I need to take the battery tray, the battery and the air box all out of this thing, get to that fourth gear switch that's on top of the transmission. Fairly easy to get to. Then you can use this actuation test and you can go in and turn on the shift solenoids just like this. Well, you see if your 5 volts is getting to it and all that kind of thing, and see if it changes state. So they're going to talk to the customer and see if she wants to go with it. She's not feeling it yet, but it has to be doing it. It's probably going from third to fifth. I'm not sure how many gears this transmission even has. I haven't looked. Basically, we need to know if she wants to go a little further with this thing, because I got to take a bunch of stuff apart. It's not a few minutes to do it. Otherwise, I would go ahead and check it. If I got my 5 volts to that switch, I can turn on the fourth gear clutch solenoid with the vehicle in the air and see if the switch changes state. If it'll let me do it with the engine running,
It won't let me do it with the engine running. That's a little harder to do. I might have to hook up a meter or a scope, take it for a drive, and when that activates the fourth gear clutch, I should see a changed state on the 5-volt reference, right? If it doesn't, then that switch could be bad. It's very possible. But with 182,000 miles, probably something in the transmission is not happening when it's supposed to, so the switch doesn't change. I would think that code would be more electrical than mechanical, but can't be sure until we try some more tests. I think I got squeaky brakes or something to look at next. So maybe we'll pull this out, see what happens with this one. We'll grab this next vehicle. 2018 Nissan Sentra. 75,683 miles. No warnings on the dash. They turn the air conditioning off. I don't understand why people insist on doing that, especially in summer. Have I mentioned yet that the car's computer turns everything off when you turn the ignition off or push the button? I don't know if I mentioned it. In any event, we're going to see if we can find a brake noise. We're going to give this a love rating of 3. It's a little messy. And we're going to see if we can hear a brake noise. Take a 4-long drive. She's waiting. I guess I did the brakes a month or two ago. She says, ever since, there's horrendous squealing. I'm like, oh my goodness gracious, what did I do? So we'll go for a drive together, and we'll figure it out. Now, of course, with the air on, it's a little noisy. Might have to raise this up off the maximum temperature. There we go. Let's take it for a drive. Maybe we'll hear something in the parking lot. I don't hear anything. Maybe we'll go this way. There's a lot of traffic coming, so see if we can hear something down these back roads. We got nice new pavement right here. Huh. Interesting. We'll be backing up. Alright. When it's slow, this is the kind of thing we normally end up doing. Little noises, and I hear a click once in a while when I go around right turns on Tuesdays. Not hearing anything. Trying not to kill anybody, and pull back in the shop. I don't park over by the office, and they'd rather walk across the parking lot. But you know what? That's just another thing in a long lost, a long, long list of things that's not up to me. Hey, Bill, do you hear a horrendous squeak out there that I can't hear in the car, maybe? I'm going to pull in the bay. You tell me. Ever since I did brakes, you hear a terrible squeak.
My ears are bleeding from the sounds. Oh, heard that. Definitely, it sounds like this wheel.
All right. Something happening in the left front. You're fired. Back your box up. Get out. Backing plates rolled a little here, but it's not touching. Got my hardware in place. Everything looks good with that. Hardware is in place. I don't know what to tell them. Give me another set of pads and rotors, we'll try again. I don't know. It's making a ton of brake dust. Huh. Not sure what we're gonna do here, but we may have to change some more parts. Everything's incorrectly, lubricated correctly. Backing plate does not look like it's touching anywhere. Let's get us a screwdriver. And oh, there's a big gap in there. It's not that, where it's rolled down on the bottom a little bit. That looks like old news. Let's see if the other one's flat on the bottom. Nope. So that must be something that happened a long, long time ago. As long as I can remember. Let me see what they want to do. If they want to scuff the rotors. We put rotors and pads on it about a month or two ago. And this makes it a little, just as you come to a stop, it goes boop. So I did hear, as soon as I called Bill over being funny, I came to a stop and I went, oh. So, all right, let me let them know, see what we do with this. Maybe some more brakes.
Be exciting, won't it?
These things are covered in tire shine.
That's what all this is, tire shine.
So this is on the, she's spraying, the tire shine was on the calipers and stuff. So they're spraying tire shine and making everything shiny. We think that's what's causing it. So I sprayed them with brake clean quite a bit and ran the wheels around and try to get as much tire shine off the rotors as I can. If you look, you can see how polished the rotors look. Really, really blows out like chrome, doesn't it? I mean, the rotors are, 1 month it's been, and they're polished pretty good. So we're gonna advise her to cut back on the tire shine. We clean the pads off with some brake clean and see if that helps. But there's nothing wrong with the brakes. If you have a glass of wine or soda or whatever in a thin glass, you put your finger in the liquid and run around the rim, it'll yee. That's what brakes do. They're trying to squeeze the rotor and they can't. And the if they always make a little noise, believe it or not, because there's harmonics going on. It's all about the pitch, whether your ear picks it up or not.
Let me go ahead.
So when you make them more slippery, your ear is going to pick it up, basically. Or if there's hardware missing, which
you got to adjust the part because when you're going to do science.
So everyone here is pretty good with brakes. So generally, something like this is either because of the tire shine or a defective set of pads or something. So if she still has more noise and cuts back in the tire shine like they asked her, we'll end up having to warranty some parts out. You guys remember this one from the other day? I put the cooling system stuff in there. We got that all buttoned up. No problem. Don't panic. We're okay. But he said, get my AC working since the engine's okay. And it feels like it has a little surge to it too. So we might mess with that a little bit. Really slow right now. So we had a meeting with the insurance guy. But basically, with my insurance monthly dues or whatever you want to call them. And then my deductible, it's going to be like $29,000 a year for insurance. Look at that. It acted like mass airflow right there. It's acting like it's got a mass airflow issue. Just shut off on me. Now, without turning the key off, we'll start it back up. The air's working. That's good. We're over one hurdle. Especially if you don't get a code. Like, let's see if that set of code. I mean, it just shut off while we were talking, right? Let's see if we got a code now. Come on now. Come on with it. Probably won't be in memory yet because I didn't shut the key off. Once you shut the key off, then the code goes to memory. Let's do a key on engine running test. So we'll do that. You hear the engine speed pick up. So we'll step on the brake. Turn the wheel half a turn and back. Push the overdrive button. Notice it on the dash. And now when the idle comes down, it'll see if it sees any problems at the moment. It did turn the AC off because it's mad I didn't turn it off. So it'll set a code. I think it's a P1464 or P1644 or something like that for AC being on when it shouldn't have been. But that's all right. I'm looking for any kind of other codes like a mass air or throttle position or something like that. The way it had that little surge and then shut off, it's definitely acting like a mass air type problem. So we'll play with it a little while, see what we can find. Well, looky, looky, looky. P1000. P1464, I'm mad you had the AC on, you son of a gun, you. Okay. Let's look under data. We'll bring up some mass airflow data and some engine speed data and see if the mass airflow data starts to drop and then the engine speed follows it, or if the engine speed drops, we're causing the mass air to follow it. The difference is very slight, so you really gotta pay attention. I wanna see barrow, that's in the mass airflow as well. When you turn the key past ignition on to crank it, it looks at the barrow real quick. Some vehicles have a separate barrow sensor, but most of them it's in the map or the mass airflow to read atmospheric pressure, so it knows how far above sea level you might be. So you gotta keep that in mind as well. That could be an issue. If it thinks you're at 1,000 feet altitude or 5,000 feet altitude and you're not, could make it run weird. Versi visa. Engine load, that relates directly to mass airflow. Then we're gonna also see if we can find mass airflow. Is all that hammering really necessary down there? Of course it's necessary. He's doing a flywheel. All right, graph. Combine just so that they're larger. So now we're gonna watch. Oh, I didn't get engine RPM. Dang it, that's all right. I'm watching mass airflow voltage. The grams a second is pretty low. Should be higher, it's a 4 liter. I wanna see 4.5 grams a second. Take the trusty mass airflow sensor tester.
That's my test stuff too.
It is high tech.
Yeah.
Diag, 1 hour.
Use your elbow.
That's a good idea. Aha! The engine shut off again. The engine load jumped up. That orange line, it went up and the engine shut off. Something going on with the mass airflow. Tapping on it didn't make a difference, but I'm still gonna have them get me one to plug in there and see. Because those lines, the way all that happened, that orange line jumping up, that's no good. The mass airflow volts dropped off. So the barrow stayed steady, 149 hertz, which is about sea level. So we'll come back doing a brake flush while they order that part. So I'm going to use this as a test part though. Before I have them get me a part, see something. Oh man, so much happier now. Let's plug that thing back in. Yeah, okay. Just want to be sure. Now I'm going to definitely get a part. This looks like a 2017 or so Honda Civic. We'll take a look. 89,126 miles. They did an oil change. And, you know, got recitals to go through and stuff, and I'm not washing your car, that costs extra. Normally what I would do for them, if they want, I'll take it to the car wash and add $10. I'm just kidding. That's a reminder for them to take it to the car wash. 2016 Honda Civic maintenance brake flush. I'm gonna give it a love rating of 7. Looks pretty nice. Got normal stuff you gotta have. Normal, you gotta have a power to your cell. Gotta have your celly hooked up, you know. Needs a little work on the door and stuff. A little cleanup work could probably be an 8. Not bad. Outside's pretty nice too. Enough of that. Let's flush the brake fluid. See how much cleaning I did? It's filthy under the cap though. That's alright. We still did a good thing. We tried our best. That's all you can really do. I can't help how they design it where all the dirt it traps in the cap. Isn't that weird? You know I'm gonna have to continue cleaning it, right? Brake flush pays 0.8. So, do what you can. You try to be as neat as you possibly can, but you basically get, 45 minutes, 50 minutes? If you do it properly, it takes about 30 to 45 minutes, really. But that's if nothing goes wrong. You don't have frozen bleeders. You can find brake fluid. It's not out of stock. You don't have to wait for it to come. and you gotta clean up after yourself. That adds a little time, but man, that magnet's crazy. All right, up in there we go. Did I open that yet? Oh, nope, I gotta open that. Which way does it go, you know? All right, straight up and down is open. Now it just gravity feeds into the brake fluid. Once the brake fluid covers the nozzle, it won't let more brake fluid come out. Science. There's my brake bleeder. Got a rubber cap on it, just above the hose connection. I'm gonna go ahead and pop that off of there. Yeah. We'll put some rags in here to protect their nice wheels. Try not to spill too much of it anyway. You guys have probably seen me do this a couple of times now. So we'll try to make it quick. I think this is not gonna fit in there and let me swing it. So that's a cool design. Thank you, Honda. Not sure what this little bump is for, but I know it has to be there. There's a gear drive in there. I'm guessing that's they geared it down so it has more power. Let me get a quarter drive 10 and ratchet and make sure that thing breaks loose nice. We'll hook this hose up, shop air. It'll draw brake fluid through the system from the master cylinder all the way back. We'll do it for about 3 to 4 minutes a wheel, depending on how good the fluid looks or bad the fluid looks. It's kind of a judgment call. If the fluid looks nice and clean to begin with, you basically probably shouldn't have sold him a brake flush, right? But it's good to do it before it gets nasty, right? So you just don't have to do it as long as it looks clean and it's been done properly. Then 2 or 3 minutes a wheel and you're probably good. You'll see nice clear fluid coming out. If the fluid looks nasty, it actually will have like a rustiness to it. That's the internal brake parts rusting. So it actually gets in the brake fluid, and that's why you flush them to get that stuff out. So we'll do that. All four wheels, it's gonna happen really quick. Pay attention.
Do the math, dummy.
All right, a little brake clean action. Everything's done on this thing. I double check my brake fluid level. Missed the spot. Double check the brake fluid level, button this thing up, and let's see if we can get something else done today. Man, it's been slow.
Damn, look at that brake fluid. On the money.
All right, this one's done.
Well, really slow. So I'm gonna mess with the project truck some on the work. These gaskets are the Remflex exhaust gaskets. If you haven't heard of them, these things are awesome. They got quite a bit of compression and forgiveness so that they can fit in a tight spot where other gaskets might fail and leak pretty soon. These tend to flex and compress and expand with temperature and all. They're supposed to be really good. I want to say I had these on my 32 Vicky. But honestly, I didn't really drive that one enough to really test them out. Everyone loves them though. That's easy. Clean the headers up a little bit. They're shorty headers. It's the only thing that's going to fit with these torsion bar suspension. If you want to use a regular long tube header, you got to take the torsion bar crossover, the torsion bar suspension out, put regular coilover suspension in. Or you can get some really odd looking headers. Do some really strange stuff. I don't want that. So shorty headers will work. If I lose 20 horsepower, my transmission lives longer. That's all right. Take all the covers off the exhaust ports. Make sure we don't leave any of those on. Because a choked engine is a sad engine. It might burn these things off, but I'm not going to try and see. Yep. These don't have slots in the ends because it can cause leaks, so they don't slot them. A little more fumbling to put them on, but I think the end product is worth a little extra fumbling for a few minutes. It hits the mount over here. To do that, I'm going to have to cut about a quarter of an inch off the corner of that mount. And I'll show you. You want to see? That's where it hits, right there.
So we gotta pull them back out and do a little modification.
That's how slow it got today. I put a header on.
I just gotta do one more now, but this one hits here. I guess you saw, I gave you guys a little background scene. I was shooting a video for the hot rod truck video while doing a day in a shop video. That's a first. I want to have a little fun with it. You guys tell me what you think. A little behind the scenes peek for my day in the shop, folks. So I hope you enjoyed today's video. Kind of slow. We got a few things done though. Hope it was worth your time and enough to torque me to torque the like button, subscribe, you know, stuff like that. Most of all, tune into the next video, I hope, because you're awesome.